Director DeSalvo, would you please read our board priorities?
I sure will. The Davenport School Board establishes the following priorities to ensure the academic success of all students. Provide leadership and direction to improve the overall learning environment in our classrooms, schools, and district, including the health, safety, security, and happiness of students and staff. Direct and support actions, programs, and activities which reduce the impacts of poverty on our students, their families, and our community.
Thank you. And Director Kluhl, would you read our mission and vision statements?
Mr. President, I'd like to defer this evening to James. If you could read our mission and vision statement, if you have it up.
Our mission statement is to enhance each student's abilities to by providing a quality education enriched by our diverse community. And our vision statement is education that challenges conventional thinking, prepares all students to compete in a global society, and inspires our students, parents, staff, and community to answer the question, what if?
Thank you. Move on to student board reports. Superintendent Tate.
Thank you, Mr. President. We'll begin with Lorraine.
So, hi, I'm Lorraine from Central. So a few cool things going on at Central recently. A few students went to perform with the SEBA Honor Band this past weekend. So they went to Iowa City West High School, pretty elite band. Our spree was actually this past weekend as well. So we had a few like spree festivities throughout the course of the last week, and we crowned our king, Salute Kargbo, on Friday at an odd, and the dance is on Saturday. He's cool. we had a team go compete at a science bowl competition up in Ames this past weekend. It was a team of five, and it was a pretty tough competition. Our drama club is putting on a murder mystery show this Friday. I believe it's at 8 p.m. if you would be interested in going. And our show choir started its season recently. So they had their first competition on January 16th up in Muscatine. And our varsity group placed sixth in the competition, and our junior varsity placed third. And we had a soloist, Lexi Sweeney, placed third in a solo competition at that Muscatine competition. So that's a wrap.
I apologize. I'm getting kind of sick. I was just in Texas, and this cold weather is getting to me. Like I said, I was in Texas. I was down there with the cheerleaders. They placed pretty well at nationals. It was in Dallas. It was with 32 teams. They placed fifth, I think, somewhere in there. And then a lot of things that are going on right now have to do with two dances that we have going on. We have our winter dance coming up, where the girl asks the guy and all that good stuff. And then the Joy Club is planning a huge dance marathon. And what's cool about this dance is that they're getting every group involved. So you have teams getting involved, you have student council getting involved. It's really cool how that's going on. And then something cool that we did today, some of our student ambassadors, we went to Wood because the Wood students sign up for their classes tomorrow. And we kind of went down there and we explained the classes and what they do in the classes and all that stuff. And then on a more personal note, I'm actually running for school board up there in the special election on February 16th.
Hello, I'm Elisa Parker-Tatum from Mid-City, and today we had two guests from the River City RME. I don't know what the E stands for, but Elise Kell and Brett Dale came to talk about the beginning of blues in the United States. Also, Riverboard Food Bank and local churches are preparing a insight food pantry for our students at our school. And during graduation, we had about 25 students graduate, and those students have already been replaced with new students this quarter. That's what I have for today. Thank you.
My name is Carolyn from West High School, and recently with the new semester, we have 5 minutes passing time now. We used to have 4 minutes because we're trying to reduce tardies, and then our show choir team got fourth place at a tournament in Kansas City, Missouri.
I'm Jim from West. This week, we opened up a poll to see which presidential candidates were most popular among our students, so we'll see how that turns out. People have been voting online, so we'll see how that turns out. Our Falcon Friends program recently held a scholarship ceremony. Two band students this weekend went to the Majorlanders competition, which is kind of like a competition for very elite musicians who go there and have a future in music. And one of our students, Colin Bell, placed third overall, so it was pretty amazing. We had our gala court presentation odd this past Thursday, and we will see who the king is this weekend on Saturday when the dance is. And finally, we had the drama club had 10-minute plays this week, and so there was a pretty decent crowd there, and so we kind of supported them, and it was pretty funny. So, yeah.
Thank you. And Gabe, you say Lorraine already carried the water for you, so you're okay? Okay, good. Well, thank you, students. It's great. Thank you for digging down and informing us about the great things going on in your schools.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to board reports. Are there any? Ooh, Director Hayes.
That a wow.
Yeah.
Now, we had our second poverty committee meeting today with community individuals, and we kind of brainstormed a little bit and talked and voted about some of the more important issues within the district and what the community could do to help us, and we seem to be getting somewhere with it.
Super, thank you. Director DeSalvo.
As you know, all of us attended the Mid-City High graduation last week or the week before, and 25 graduates, so that was quite an honor to be there, and it was a very exciting program. So I would invite anybody that gets the opportunity. It just brings tears to your eyes, any graduation anyway, but that was a really, really nice ceremony for those kids, so way to go for them. And then this past Saturday, several of us, five of us attended the NAACP Forum on Education. We've got some ideas and some questions and some things that I jotted down some notes, so did Dr. Tate, and we'll be kind of comparing notes and getting answers back at the next meeting, which I believe is going to be sometime in March.
Director Snyder. Nothing?
No, they pretty well covered it.
Okay, great. Are there any other board reports? Director Kluhl.
And immediately following the forum, Director DeSalvo, Director Snyder, President Johansson, and myself attended the NAACP Education Summit at Third Missionary Baptist Church, one of their regularly scheduled meetings, and they asked board members to attend and participate. We attended. We were there, I think it was probably an hour and a half or so. Dr. Tate was there as well. And it was just a good communication session, allowing us as board members to hear some of the concerns of the community. We, you know, very concerned about open meetings, so we did not offer much in the way of discussion during that meeting. It was mostly a listening session for us, but we have been invited back. I think it's on March 12th, Vera, for the next meeting, at which time some of the issues that we talked about, the board will have a response for. So we appreciate very much being asked to attend, and we feel that it was probably good for the community. It was certainly good for the board as well.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? Got a little bit here. I do need, or we need, a board member to volunteer to serve on a wellness committee. this is a it's an administration committee, but they're asking for volunteers. I'd appreciate anybody that wants to participate on that. Get your name to Mary, and we'll go ahead and make a selection. I'm sure that everybody here knows that we have a special election coming up, and it's to fill a Davenport School Board vacancy. And this election is going to be held on Tuesday, February 16th. There are 8 vote center sites that have been set, and residents who live within the Davenport Community School District boundaries, and that includes Bluegrass, Buffalo, and Walcott, are encouraged to vote at any one of these centers, and they're going to be open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. on February 16th. The vote center sites, I just want to review. There are 8 sites. First is the Bluegrass Public Safety Building on 606 West Main Street, Bluegrass. St. Mark's Lutheran Church, 2363 West 3rd Street, Davenport. United Neighbors, 808 Harrison Street, Davenport. KSI, which is the Center for Active Seniors, 1035 West Kimberly Road, Davenport. Prince of Peace Lutheran Church, 415 West 53rd Street, Davenport. Duck Creek Park Lodge, 3300 East Locust Street, Davenport. Scott Community College / West Davenport Center, 2950 North Fairmount Street, Davenport. And the Unitarian Church, 3707 Eastern Avenue, Davenport. Registration is going to be allowed at all of these centers as well. And so eligible voters who have not registered to vote may do so at the Scott County Auditor's Office, which is 600 West 4th Street, from Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. And eligible voters may register at the vote center sites prior to voting on the day of the election. And voters can obtain additional information by calling 563-326-8631 or go to the Scott County Auditor's website. We have 7 candidates that submitted their nomination papers, and I won't give all of the address and information, but I will list those people, and that's Megan Long, Elaine Cressy, Clyde Mayfield, Bruce Werning, Andrew DeNoyer. Now, Izzy, we call you Izzy, but it says Eliezer. Eliezer, okay. So Izzy is one of our school board student members. Eliezer Parker Tatum, but we call her Izzy. And Erica Call. So thank you all for putting your names into the cycle here, and we're happy that all of you are participating, and we look forward to a great campaign event here. We've only got about 3 weeks, so it's going to be tough for all of the candidates, but good luck to all. All right. You can go ahead and make that report as chairman of the Legislative Advocacy Committee.
Just wanted to note that tentatively we are proposing, and I have a request out to the rest of the Legislative Advocacy Committee, to sponsor a legislative forum for school board candidates on Thursday, the 4th of February at 5 p.m. Location yet to be determined, but most likely here in the boardroom. That's February 4th at 5 p.m. here in the Administrative or the Achievement Services Center. So we want to give candidates an opportunity to be able to express their views on on the issues, give the public the opportunity to know who it is that they're voting for. So we look forward to holding that. We will be making announcements and sending out announcements to all of the nominees, so you'll get that personally as well.
All right, thank you. Move on to the showcase, Superintendent Tate.
Thank you, Mr. President. Central High School, calling Principal McKissick to make the introductions.
Good evening. First of all, I'd like to thank the board and the superintendent for allowing us to come before you this evening. I'm very proud of the many great things that happen each and every day at Davenport Central. Tonight, we want to share some information with you regarding our Boys to Men program. Ed Vesey, our associate principal, supervises the program along with a number of just outstanding volunteers that meet regularly with a core group of select students. At this time, I'm going to give the microphone over to Mr. Vesey, and he'll share the parameters and the highlights of the program. Ed?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. McKissick. Thank you, board, for this opportunity. This is my second year at Davenport Central as an associate principal there, and I'm just going to give you a quick background about our Boys to Men program. Last year, I found myself talking with Mr. Tatum here in James Porter, who's our attendance coach at Central, just about things and opportunities for our young African-American men and our Latino men and what we thought was lacking at Central. We, without Mr. McKissick's permission, and he knows this already, it's not a secret, kind of just threw together a program quickly. We had a group of about 30 kids last year, and we named it Boys to Men. We stole the name. It's been around, and some folks know that for a long time, and just basically put our own program together. And there were truly some bumps in the road, but some things that happened out of that. Marlo Clark, who is here, was at the Y, or still is at the Y. We brought him on board, and he quickly became our money person. When we wanted food or whatever, we went right to Marlo, and Marlo took care of things for us that way. So we were able, with some programming, to feed our kids. And we all know, if you feed them, they shall come, especially high school boys. So to make a long story short with that, we tweaked our program through the guidance of Mr. McKissick and some feedback from our young men last year, and we changed some things. We've learned that high school boys don't want you to talk at them. They want you to listen and also be there to guide them. So basically, Boys to Men is a program. And at this time, Mr. Tatum, would you hand out our brochure so you'll have a quick reference guide? I'll introduce our mentors. Again, Marlo Clark, from the Y, Mr. Tatum, who works at Central. Sherwin Robinson, who's a barber here in Davenport, is here with us. James Porter and Delano Davis and myself are the mentors that work with our boys. We meet twice a month in the morning. And again, we rely on Mr. Clark to help feed our young men. And we get 15 to 20 young men to show up at 7:30 in the morning, which is difficult, but they do. They show up, and again, we just have a session in which the boys talk about life issues, talk about academic issues and problems, and basically the mentors are there to help steer them in the right direction. And at this time, we are fortunate enough to have with us two of our young men from the program who we would like you to hear from. We have Mr. Dwayne Sleet, who is a senior, and Dejon Thorpe. So at this time, I'll ask them just to give an overview of the Boys to Men program at Central.
Good afternoon, or good evening now. My name is Dwayne Sleet, and I'm a senior at Davenport Central,
And Boys to Men, to me, really is just it's a great opportunity to come together with a few other individuals and actually just be able to sit down and be able to talk about what we're going through and just to have someone to listen to you. It's different from when you talk to your parents or you talk to a teacher, because they only can see one side of it. They can't see like the whole picture, or like they don't understand quite what you're going through. But when you talk to some other individuals who've gone through things that you're going through, or you've talked to just other people who are around your age group, it gives you an opportunity to be able to just feel like you can like express yourself, and you'll be able to be in a safe environment to where you won't have to worry about, oh, I have to worry about what I'm saying, or I have to be very guarded. I can just speak truly what is on my mind. So if like something that's bothering you, it gives you just a chance to be able to talk to someone. Another great thing about Boys to Men is just the fact that we get to make almost a brotherhood. And these people you see in the hallway, you actually make relationships that you might not have made before. As a senior, I might not talk to the freshman per se because I'm a senior. But this group is giving me a chance to meet all types of individuals and all types of people I can call my friends and my brothers now, because just that we've created a bond of together, of being together and seeing each other. Another great thing about just being in the Boys to Men group, it just gives you a chance to, as people in the middle, because you always see with schools, they help people who are always at the top or people who are at the bottom. But it's always the people who are in the middle who seem to just get left out. And this group really focused on those people who are in the middle and who don't quite get the shine of maybe someone who's has a 4.0 or something, and then they don't get quite as much help as the student who's barely getting along, who's barely showing up. And it feels like that they've given us a chance just to feel like, honestly, that we matter and that people care about us, that we're just not going through the motions, and that all of our good deeds don't go unnoticed.
Good evening. My name is Dejan Thorpe. I'm a junior at Central. And Boys to Men for me has done a lot. I feel like it's someone that I can go to and talk to people, and people listen. And a lot of kids around my age, it's like it's easier to relate to them and listen to what they go through, and then tell them what I have done with my life and stuff like that. And I like how we talk about our goals every week and what we want to accomplish, and have we accomplished them, and what they can do to help us. And like they push us to do things that even I didn't think I could do. Like when my grades are now, I didn't think I could do it, but with their help, I mean, it's gotten there. And like Dwayne said about people in the middle, they don't get as much recognition as the people at the top or the bottom. So I feel like this group is more focused on the people in the middle. So, yeah.
At this time, I'd like to bring up Marlo Clark. And Marlo again, from the Y, and so we've partnered with Marlo on the Y. So, Marlo.
Hi, I'm Marlo, and I am not the money man, by the way. Obviously, my program, Y Achievers, that you all saw about 2 months ago, we fundraised quite a bit of money to help teenagers. So we willingly help out. Again, they stole my line, where it's just the kids in the middle. My program, Y Achievers, is kids in the juvenile criminal system. So those kids get plenty of attention from the court system and mentoring programs. And the kids who are doing great athletes, usually have great systems at home and their families. I want to work with them with this group. We are kids who are doing well. Just how do you go to college? How does college work? The grades are all great grades, but what does the process look like? What is a roadmap to being a welder or being an engineer? Because the first meeting, we were like, what do you want to do? And they said, well, engineer and this and that, and how do you get there? And there was no real direction. And also, we want to get engaged in the community as well. So partly, when it snows outside, people who are older can't shovel their own driveways. So I go pick kids up, and we go shovel the driveways for them. This summer, there was a lady who had cancer, 85 years old, and couldn't mow her lawn anymore. Well, we mowed our lawn for her. So those are all the things we do. We're working with the new mayor, Frank Clips, to paint murals this summer. We have a lot of train track things. They're pretty bland looking. Well, how do we get young men to go and just start doing things in the community that they can own as well? And that's pretty much what the program is. It's just people who just need my job at the Y is to talk to people, usually people who are in trouble. But this one's just an opportunity to talk to people who are doing well, who just need some direction as well on their path towards success. Any questions for any of us?
I imagine there are. Anybody? Director Hayes.
From the two that spoke, it sounds like you both have quite the passion for the program. You sound really excited when you were talking about the program. You mentioned that there were like 15 to 20 people that would show up in the morning. Is there like a CAPS? Is it like a drop-in program or whoever's available that day? Or how does that work?
There's no real criteria for the program. Obviously, we started with many, many more kids of all races. These ones are the ones that stayed. It's as simple as that. There were some who were doing great, some weren't doing very great, some were in the middle, some were black, some were white. These ones are the ones who just saw value in it and stayed. If other kids, teachers refer as well to Rodney, and we meet with them before to find out, is this what you want to do? Because by enrolling in this program, you're enrolling in my program as well by Achievers, where we help you through a number of issues, whether it's food or clothes or shelter. So it's a kind of a core program, and teachers refer to Rodney, and then you evaluate from there. But it's available to pretty much all the students at Central High School. It's just the ones that stayed and saw value in it.
Director Snyder.
Dwayne and Dijon, I want to find out, how did you guys hear about the program and what made you guys decide to give it a try?
Well, how I heard about the program was from James Porter. He approached me and just said, this is a group that will give you the opportunity just to go out into the community and you can be able to make relationships. So I thought, you know what, I'll just stop in to see how it is. And ever since I first came to the first meeting, I've always enjoyed the meetings. I always find them very informational. Meeting people has been just great.
I heard about it from Mr. Tatum, and he just told me about the meeting, and I showed up, and I enjoyed it, so I just continued to come. And it's gotten better since we first started until now, so I think I'll keep coming.
That's great, guys. Thank you.
Director DeSalvo.
I think one of you mentioned that you have a business partner, the barber. And I didn't really have a question specifically for you, but I think that's great that you're bringing in business for these kids to see. You know, maybe one of them wants to be a barber or an engineer. I think that's fantastic that you're contributing to the schools.
You're pushing me up here. My name is Sherwin, by the way.
Thank you.
You mentioned barber. I find it a great joy because when they say they'd like to talk to us, and they share, when they share, they open up. So it gives me an opportunity. When they share, I can tell them where I come from, because I've always been a barber, but I have worked in the school system. And over the years, I've been a volunteer. I'm volunteer through the ambassador program, as well as this right here. And you can never give enough. So it's a great joy for me as well to work with these guys. And we say boys to men, but I try to look at them as boys to young men, because they have to come up to where we are right now. And we could never volunteer or... And like you said, coming from all walks of life, I am a man of the community. I've been a product of the Davenport Community School District. And so I just feel like it's great for me to give back to where I've come from.
Well, thank you for doing that. And to Dwayne and Deshaun, pay it forward. Keep it going, guys. When you move on and you graduate, come back to us and do the same thing. I didn't catch your name. I'm sorry. Do the same thing. Come back and show these kids all that you've accomplished and how this program helped you get there. So excellent job. Really, really proud of you.
Anybody else? Director Kluel.
I thought this concept of the student in the middle was very interesting, you know, when you first brought that up. Because I think it's probably true. A lot of times in school, we look at the kids that are up at the top. We've got the TAG programs. We give them lots of attention. We put them out in front of audiences. They go to fairs and stuff like that. Kids on the bottom, we're trying to work with them to get their scores up, get them back into the routines. But students in the middle sometimes become invisible. And so I think that's a great idea. And, you know, and as I'm thinking about this, I'm thinking what we normally do in school is we talk about subjects, and we go from one subject to another. We go from one class, the bell goes off, we go to another class, we go from literature to math. But actually, each class, each subject is more like a lens of learning things. It's a lens to knowledge. Knowledge is what school is about. Math is not so much different than social studies, than English. There are just different ways of learning. And I think this Boys to Men program helps to exhibit that in terms of taking you out of an academic subject, because what you're doing is still school, but you're, again, kind of breaking down the walls of the school building and doing things beyond at the barbershop and getting outside, and you're talking. You're breaking down boundaries between people that are older than you. And that's big, because I tell you, that's what employers are looking for when you go out on the job market. They want people that can look somebody in the eye, like you're doing right now, which I appreciate. And it makes a difference, a big difference. So that, and just the thing that the barber said about it's better to give than receive. And you guys might not understand that yet, but as you get older, you start to understand that what these guys are doing for you is giving them much more than maybe you're actually receiving from them. And that's the beauty of the whole thing. Thank you for what you're doing.
Anybody else? A couple of things. It's interesting on the brochure that you passed out, the Boys to Men, Nurturing the Leaders of Tomorrow. And I just appreciate those words. I really do. We need leaders in so many areas in our country. And so I love the idea, and especially of nurturing leaders. And I appreciate the program. One of the things that one of you, Dwayne or Dijon, you talked about goals for each week. And I was wondering if you could explain a little bit what that kind of looks like. What does it feel like? Does it help you? Just explain a little bit more about that.
Well, as far as that, it's like for me, like my grades were like a goal to get like a higher grade average. So like 1 week I would write it down, and then I'll go on to Tatum a week or two after, and he asks me, well, did I get the grade that I wanted? Did I get my homework turned in? Was I on time for class? And going and knowing I'm going to go in there and see him, I want to make sure that I got that goal down that I written down. So I think it does help to write our goals down. It helps a lot.
No, that's super. I really appreciate that, and I appreciate all the work that all of you are putting into this. That's fantastic. Any other questions, comments? All right. Thank you all. Okay, great. We'll move on to communications. Director Hayes, would you please read our upcoming events?
Yes, I'll be happy to. January 27th from 2 to 5 p.m., student-built open house will be held at 7122 Madison Street in Davenport. On February 2nd at 4 o'clock, the Legislative Advocacy Committee will be here in the ASC Executive Boardroom. On February 2nd, Tuesday, from at 5:30 p.m., the Committee of the Whole will be held here in the ASC Jim Hester Boardroom. Date changed due to political caucuses, which is on the first Monday of February. February 3rd at 4 o'clock p.m., the Policy Committee will be held here in the ASC Executive Boardroom. February 8th at 6 o'clock, the regular meeting will be here in the ASC Jim Hester Boardroom. February 9th at 5:30 p.m., the ELSIAC Local School Improvement Advisory Committee meeting will be held here in the ASC Jim Hester Boardroom. February 15th, students get on the bus trip to Des Moines. February 16th, the special election from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. See list of voting centers on the front table by the agenda if you're needing to have that. On February 22nd, at 6 o'clock p.m., the regular meeting will be held here in the ASC Jim Hester Boardroom.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to open forum. We have no open forum requests, but I do want to remind everybody, that we really do appreciate members of our community coming and speaking at open forum, and it's an opportunity to come and speak about school district issues. Just want to remind everybody to keep coming and giving us your thoughts. We'll move on to the consent agenda. May I have a motion?
Mr. President.
Director Snyder.
I move that the board accept the consent agenda as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
A second.
Is there any discussion? Okay, call for the vote. Director Snyder.
Yes.
Director Hayes.
Yes.
Director Gosa.
Yes.
Director Kluhl.
Yes.
Director DeSalvo.
Yes.
My vote is yes. Motion carries. Thank you. May I have a motion regarding approval of bills?
Mr. President.
Director Kluel.
I move that the board approve the following resolution regarding the approval of bills. The resolution is as follows. Resolved, all claims presented to the board having been duly certified as correct by the secretary and reviewed by the administration and board members, and they are hereby audited and allowed as just claims and warrants drawn in the treasury for the several amounts. Further resolved, the payment of claims and salaries be approved as presented for the periods of January 7th, 2016 through January 20th, 2016 with the following voided check, and that being check number 334415 in the amount of $17,986 payable to St. Ambrose University. Reason for that is that it was a void check and was replaced.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Okay, we'll call for the vote. Director Kluel?
Yes.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Snyder?
Yes.
Director DeSalvo?
Yes.
Director Gosa?
Yes.
My vote is yes. Motion carries. Thank you. Superintendent report.
Thank you, Mr. President. 2 years ago, when we were doing budgeting, we targeted savings for utility expenditures of $130,000, and that was to take place last year. So last year, we put in place an energy committee, met monthly, and the point of the committee was to find ways that we could, by changing human nature or human activity, actually save money and find that $130,000. So it took us a while to put it together because it's not as easy as we thought it'd be to just to find out how much we expended 1 year to the next. But between the 2014-15 school year and the 2013-14 school year, we actually saved $361,649. Now that sounds great. We said good, but then Mr. Maloney says, wait a minute, we need to check the temperatures and see if some of that happened to be that we had a really tough winter in 13-14. It wasn't quite as bad as 14-15. And he was right. Probably 170,000 of those savings was the fact that it was just we had a milder winter last year than the year before. But what that means is about $191,000 was due to savings of other things besides just that we had a better winter. So then he even went further and said, wait a minute, some of that has to do with we actually did some retrogrades in some of our schools, and the whole point is we want to save money doing that. And we found out when we took out those retrogrades that actually about $140,000 was saved because we were doing things differently, turning off lights, we were doing energy audits in our schools, and trying to save money any way we could with utilities. So we certainly met our goal of $130,000, and our energy committee continues to meet and continues to find ways to save money for two reasons. We want to keep our planet as healthy and green as possible, but also we'd like to use that money for other things such as teachers and programs. It was mentioned that we all went to a meeting last week with the NAACP. I did take some notes. I apologize for handing you paper, but things went rather quickly today, and I just couldn't get it into your board docs. And those are my recollections of some of the major issues, and then my thoughts about what we should work on covering at the meeting on March 12th. So you don't need to discuss that tonight, but certainly if you have any changes to it, let me know, and then the board will be discussing at a later time exactly what we should deal with on March the 12th when we meet again. I also have another piece of paper, I apologize for that, to pass out, and it's our communication plan for the media concerning the special election. And just in general, as you look down it, you can see that there's already been a couple e-letters that have been sent out. There's been a joint press release between the district and the county auditor's office. We've emailed to our network of community and partners all the voting locations. We're putting it on our website, and we're going to put it on the Brady Street sign. And then we have radio advertisements, about 30 radio spots. And then in progress, we are going to look at other ways to make sure that we publicize the fact that, you know, where you can attend and where you can elect, do your election, your voting, and also that really you can go to any of these. You don't have to go to a certain assigned precinct. So I give you this for your information, And Dawn will continue to give us an update on where we are with any changes as she makes the communication plan. Mr. President, that concludes my presentation.
Thank you very much. Move on to other items requiring action. May I have a motion regarding approval of change order from Centennial Contractors?
Mr. President.
Director Kluhl.
Move that the board approve a central pool and auditorium change order in the amount of $115,860.25 from Centennial Contractors of the Quad Cities.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion?
I have a question for
Director Snyder.
I have a question for Mr. Maloney. I know we were curious from day one what we'd find in the soil there, and I'm assuming that there is contingency money still left in this project that is going to be covering the
change order. This change order will be taken from the construction contingency budget. I think this particular change order represents the highest degree of risk that we have in the project, that being soils underground. We are well above that at this point, so I think this will most likely be the largest single change order we face. Recall in November we did have a $90,000 deductive change order. I expect another deductive change order. We've continued to do some value engineering. That probably be before you next month. Overall, we're within the total budget that had been established, and we'll have more information during the discussion item about that.
Perfect. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Director Kluhl.
Well, just a concern, and I don't know if you have a response to it or not, but one of the issues that we talked about early on was the soils, and Mr. Larrison assured us that he's done a lot of work on the grounds there, and they followed up with soil sampling. I mean, is this reasonable to be unexpected to come up at this point and say that there were problems with the soil compaction, soil structure after having done the studies?
Yes, yes, it's reasonable. We did do a number of borings, our geotechnical engineer, prior to beginning the construction. And what you always end up faced with is you could do a boring on every 10 feet in a grid and spend a lot of money characterizing the soil that precisely. And if you did that, you would have identified exactly these unsuitable soils, which then you would have solved by pile foundations. So you do a bit of boring before the project starts, you characterize the general nature of the site, then during excavation we have the geotech engineer on site continuously. They're doing testing, they're examining the soils, and when we find unsuitable soils, we switch from the spread footings to more expensive driven pile foundations. So it's you could do more work characterizing the soils in the beginning, but it would not change the outcome of having to use the pile foundations.
Yeah, I just remember having the same problems with the new gymnasium. Is that fill in there?
There's a variety of strata depending upon what portion of the site you're in.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else? I've got a question that I have to ask now because I probably won't remember it in the future. Doesn't have too much to do with this, but you mentioned value engineering with respect to some future change orders that are probably going to happen. I was just curious, how does value engineering happen and who participates? How does it come up?
Ordinarily, it might involve the construction manager, myself, the district's project manager, the architect, and one or more of the subcontractor trades involved, where we would look at the plans as they were bid and say, what could we do differently? I mentioned the masonry change order that you approved that was a deductive $90,000. We changed, for one thing, the size of the exterior cladding brick to larger brick, which then requires less labor to install. We also changed the cladding of some interior columns from glazed brick to a prefabricated kind of cover that will be like fluted, kind of make it look like a fancy interior column. But the glazed brick change was about a $20,000 savings. So the architect's original ideas are that we do this, we get the masonry contractor, others in the room, and say, is there anything we can do to save on the masonry? And that's the way that process works.
All right. Thank you. It's interesting, and I really appreciate it. Any other discussion? Okay, we'll call for the vote. Director Kluel.
Yes.
Director Snyder.
Yes.
Director Gosa.
Yes.
Director Hayes.
Yes.
Director DeSalvo.
Yes.
My vote is yes. Motion carries. Thank you. We have a motion regarding approval of contract with Netrix.
Mr. President.
Director Hayes.
Administration recommends the board approve the contract with Netrix in the amount of $67,820.55.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Director Kluel.
I was just curious on this. I understand, Gary, that this was a responsive bid. Everything that you wanted was included in the contract. My question is, the board has a responsibility to accept the lowest responsible responsive bid. Is this a responsible bid? I don't know what the estimate was. There were no other bids, so I don't know.
Our experience has been that this is a very responsible bid given the quality of this company. Similar projects that we've had have been higher than this one for the type of things we're getting done. We're real excited about working with this company. They have a great track record, all the history that we've done looking them up and stuff. So,
okay. Sounds responsible to me, I guess.
Any other discussion? All right, we'll call for the vote. Director Hayes.
Yes.
Director DeSalvo.
Yes.
Director Gosa.
Yes.
Director Snyder.
Yes.
Director Kluel.
Yes.
My vote is yes. Motion carries. Thank you. May I have a motion regarding approval of the district diversity plan?
Mr. President.
Director DeSalvo.
I move that the board approve the changes to the district diversity plan as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Director DeSalvo.
I have one question about a ratio, and I think I know what it is, but let me find my spot here. In the plan itself, there's a chart on page, five. Thank you. Where it lists each school, their category, and then the student ratio.
Yes.
What makes up the ratio?
What makes up the ratio? It would be category A to category B.
I tried that math and it didn't work. I must have been really tired when I was
that
trying
to. 288 yeah. to 22. Okay. We'll give it a 13 to 1 ratio for the first building there.
I was trying to calculate this last night and I couldn't get it to balance, but that's what I figured it was, but I couldn't. I must have been user error. Thank you.
While you're on that page, Donna and I talked this morning, and the page you're looking at right now has 1.92 under the student ratio, and it has 2.1 under the school type. We think that's confusing, so I'm giving you a new page, which I will suggest, if you approve the diversity plan, that I would submit, and all it does is put the ratios right beside each other, so one doesn't expect that it's a different calculation for each one. So it's a very simple change just to make it, I think, more direct.
Director DeSalvo.
So in the plan, things weren't highlighted that had changed? I mean, the biggest change is the A to B and the in and out. Is that a fair statement? Because I was trying to compare it to another plan, and I didn't know that I had an older plan to know what had changed.
I think there's two major changes. One is that we are using just SES yes. as our key demographic. And then the other one is that we are going to maintain, like if we have seven students who come into the district, mm-hmm. we will allow seven students out. To leave the district based on whether they're a Category A or Category B student.
So as the plan reads, filling in that information, everything else remains consistent with the references and such.
Yeah, exactly. So
that's what I thought.
There were several places we had to take things out and put them in because we went from both the SES and using performance. So that took, but everything else is exactly the same. Philosophy, background, references, everything.
Very good. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Director Kluhl.
Well, I told the board secretary that this would be the last time as a board member that I have the opportunity to probably talk about the diversity plan, and I'll keep it rather brief, but just to summarize, I will, Mary. It will be somewhat brief, but I need to go into some detail. I appreciate what we've done with this plan. It's a vast improvement over the previous one where we had both socioeconomic status and performance on standardized tests is the criteria on which we based our open enrollments. SES is a reasonable criterion to use. I will be voting no on this for two reasons. One is that I still believe that race is important in terms of balance in our schools. I think it was interesting, somebody sent me an article today that said that 60% of African Americans would prefer that the government got involved in racially balancing schools. I thought that was a very interesting number. Not nearly so many white people did, but the majority of African Americans would have appreciated that. I think it's important in our schools. I look back and I think of Plessy versus Ferguson, which I think was in the late 1890s, which said that separate but equal is a fact. If we could have a racially segregated school, it was equal to one that was integrated. 1954, Brown versus Board of Education said, no, separate but equal is a fallacy. A school that is separate, that is racially segregated, does not have the same opportunities as one that is integrated. And so in 2007, we go back to the Supreme Court's decision that we're a colorblind society and that in fact now, it's okay for schools to be segregated. And that's exactly what's happening. Schools are becoming more and more racially segregated throughout the nation. And I'm concerned about that. And I think that a future board will have to deal with this issue. But I think I want you student school board members to know that even though you know you've heard this before and you know probably how the vote's going to come out, 6-1, 5-1, still it's important to stand up for what you believe in and express your concerns. And after the vote's taken, you accept what the board's intelligence has provided. But the second reason that I will object is because I disagree with the 1-1 ratio, one student in, one student out. I really believe that what we are about as board members in the state of Iowa is doing the best that we can. And I'm looking at you. I'm sorry. I'm really talking to the board. What am I looking at you for? But that we have a responsibility for all Iowa students. And true, we have a market share in Davenport that we're responsible for, and we're trying to retain students. But this is going to be one more step that a board in the future is going to have to overcome when it comes time that we have finally reached the status where students don't want to enroll out of Davenport, that they want to be in Davenport schools. And with District of Distinction, that's happening. So this is one more backup step that the board in the future is going to have to take back when we get to that point where we are the District of Distinction. So I just wanted to express that. I've got a year and a half left on the board. I doubt that this will come up again. Again, it's my position, it's my feeling. I felt that it's it's incumbent on board members to talk about these issues in the open. You know, there's some concern about the city council right now and some of the meetings that they're having that are not open to the public, but this board says everything in the public because this is the public's business and you deserve to know how we arrive at the decisions that we make. And there are differences of opinion and that leads to better decisions. And maybe next time it'll go my way. Thank you. I can see your look.
Any more discussion? Nobody? Director DeSalvo.
I would just comment that I like the plan. I like the one in, one out. And I respect the transfer within, you know, to totally respect Director Kluel and what he's saying and that, you know, we have to, he would like to base some of this on race, but I don't know that that would be so necessary because any student can go anywhere. We can move an A to a B and a B to an A. So I would disagree a little bit with your sense there of that occurring in our school. So I think it's a good plan.
Anybody else? Well, I've got a few things. Because as Director Kluel points out, this probably will be the last time we've discussed this for a while. I was wondering about the sense of urgency, Superintendent Tate.
We would like to get it to the Department of Education and back approved, hopefully, before we go into our open enrollment season, which starts on the 1st of March, and we have to have decisions by the end of March.
So when does the department need this in order to get it back before the open enrollment season starts?
30 days ago, but I hope I can get them to make a fast decision. They say 60 days, but I don't think it's going to take that long for this. So.
Okay. Part of the reason I ask it is that in reading through this, one of the things that I think about is how does it really affect us. And I know that you've presented the one in, one out, what may have happened, but have you done any math modeling on this to see how it would have changed things, say, from last year, other than the simple one in, one out that you presented at a recent meeting? I'm just wanting to make sure that there aren't any unintended consequences of making this change. And I'm just wondering if it's possible to do a model or if it's possible to characterize what the changes would be one last time.
Are you talking monetary or?
No.
I mean.
I'm talking students. How does this affect students?
Well, what was the difference on what went out and what came in last year? It was we sent 14 out and we got net about 30 something in.
We had 14 that came in and we approved 65 students to leave the district.
But how many actually left the district?
35.
Which was very interesting. I hadn't realized that 65 applied but 35 left. So monetarily, you know, we're saving $150,000 to $200,000 each year. And I don't know what else to say. I mean, there's the difference. And
you're saying then that it would have been 14 and 14, right?
Correct, if we follow this plan.
And I suppose there's no way of knowing exactly what the reasons were for the requests. To me, this is a really, really big deal. I just want to make sure that we're doing the right thing. This is going to the Department of Education. They will make a decision. Now, they may not like this plan. Is that correct?
I can't imagine they would not. There are other districts that use socioeconomic status alone. In fact, they say it's illegal to use performance, so the fact that we're taking academic performance out of there should fill them full of glee. Our diversity plan looks like all the others that we're sending in. It's simpler. It maintains the ratio. It has an internal component to it. So I think we meet everything, and I don't anticipate any issues, and I think we can get it through pretty quickly.
Okay. Some of the wording in here is, and I'm sure that you worked on the wording, but one of the characterizations, I guess I'll call it, is non-low SES. And there's something about that phrase that just bothers me, and I don't know even what it is. It's like low SES is a minority, but we're going to call it group A, and non-low SES is non-minority that'll be B. Is that kind of
That's right? Correct.
And I suppose it was done in the sense of making things clear. Is that kind of right?
Yeah, it does. To trying to make things clearer and then to throw in some other terms. I mean, you could do low SES, you could do paid, high income, low income. I mean, there's a variety of terms we could use, but we had used a low SES, and just kind of the opposite of low SES was non-low SES.
And low SES is really only, it only deals with fee waivers and free and reduced lunch, right?
Correct.
I think that's what I read in there.
Correct.
It just seems, I don't know, there's something about it that bothers me.
Well, perhaps it's also the final irony is that the minority is actually a majority.
Yeah, that bothers me.
And we kept away from minority after the initial definition because we have to include the definition when you asked us to stay away from that, so that's why we went to category A and B
sure.
right away.
No, I understand it. It just, no, well. One of the things Director Kluhl talked about is the District of Distinction, and he talked about it as if it were in the future. And I was thinking that it's in the present. And that this is a district of distinction. I wanted to take the opportunity, however, to note that our district, along with some other districts in the state, have been disallowed from spending as much per pupil as a lot of other districts. And I don't remember the total, but I think the administration, our CFO calculated it once, and my recollection is that Davenport has not been able to spend about $120 million over the last 40 years, that it may have been
143
million, excuse me, and thank you for correcting me. But I think that it really, there's something about this that suggests to me that there's an unfairness in the way that the funding formula has been established and implemented through the years. And $143 million would have made a difference in this district, I believe. So I think that we do have a great district, a great community, and it will continue to be getting better. Is there any other discussion? Director Kluhl.
Let me only add that I think this is a great district, too. I spend my time working on this board because I believe it's a great district, and for some reasons it's a great district because I'm on this board, if I may say so. But the critical mass of perception is working against us yet at this point, and it's at that point that I will say this is a district of distinction. When we have moved that critical mass of perception in our favor, which it deservedly should be, but isn't yet.
Any other, Director DeSalvo.
I had one other question, and I should have had my notes, and I didn't, forgive me. How many other districts in the state have a diversity plan? Can you repeat that for
There's
us?
There's a total of five in the state, with us being one of them.
Okay, and it was Waterloo?
Waterloo, Postville, West Liberty, and Des Moines.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other discussion? One thing I got to say, as I've thought about this, and I do think about the future, and this is a really tough plan. Director Kluhl and I have been on the board long enough to recall that last adopted February 11th, 2008, and some of the chaos that existed back then in trying to get the original voluntary desegregation plan changed into a district diversity plan. And things happened so fast back then because of the Supreme Court issue or decision and because of the recommendations made by our lawyers and just all sorts of things that were going on. I think the decision was made like in 2 weeks, if I recall. And who knows how long any of us will be on this board. But I do want to say that in the future, I do hope also that this plan could be significantly changed or even eliminated. So that comment won't affect the way that I vote tonight, but it is my thinking for somewhere in the future. Any other discussion? Okay, we'll call for the vote. Director DeSalvo.
Yes.
Director Hayes.
Yes.
Director Snyder.
Yes.
Director Kluhl.
No.
Director Gosa.
Yes.
And my vote is yes. Motion carries. Thank you. We have a couple of discussion items. We're doing pretty good time-wise. So we'll move on to the periodic review of the Central Project. Superintendent Tate.
The experts come forward even though we speak, so thank you for being here, gentlemen. Appreciate it.
We wanted to take an opportunity just to give you a very brief update on the status of the budget, the schedule, and so forth for the Central High Pool and Auditorium and related projects, but also to give you the opportunity to ask any questions you might have at this time. This project is our largest one underway, of course. It is complex and challenging. And have Eric Page, District's Project Manager, and Brian Hedgren with Russell Construction here with me tonight to also answer questions. Mr. Larrison is out of town and unable to attend. I'd like to start and thank Brian and Eric for the scores of things that they take care of every day that don't come to my attention and encourage them to do more of that. This, of course, is the rendering of the pool and auditorium, and those of you who have been out and about see that it is starting to take actual shape in real life, and the column in the foreground there is the highest part, the southwest corner of the lobby of the auditorium. We have a lot of space enclosed there working with winter conditions right now. We've actually been pretty fortunate with the weather overall, although the workers on the ground tell you that actually when things are cold and frozen, they kind of like that because it's a lot less muddy. The total, the grand total, all projects, the pool auditorium, the roof, the relocation of the front office, ADA, the tennis courts and parking lot, everything end to end, the grand total budgeted is $28,189,931. And that includes the completed parking lot and tennis courts up at Brady and so forth, the pool, the auditorium, and so forth. We currently have budgeted $1.597 million for furniture, fixtures, and equipment. And as we stand here today, that's around $300,000 short of what we think we're going to need for furniture, fixtures, and equipment. We believe that some of that will come from the construction budget above. There's still some value engineering work to do. And in regards to furniture and fixtures equipment, we've gone around and we've taken table saws out of wood shops and things like that around the district. And those are what we'll use in the scene shop in the auditorium, for example. And there's other examples of existing furniture fixtures that we've identified that we'll be able to use to save some of that. The pool and auditorium proper is now projected budget-wise to be at $22,154,758. Now, you recall originally Mr. Larrison proposed something on the order a little bit above $18 million. After we went out to bid on May 12th of 2015, the board approved the project for the pool and auditorium alone at $21,113,263. That's after all the bids in. Some adjustments that were made to the project were explained. Mr. Larrison was here at that time and the rest of us. And the 21113 is what the board approved. In July of last year, I came to the board and said we should add $500,000 of additional construction contingency budget. And so that is part of what we currently have budgeted. And then recall there was a separate budget line item for renovation of the existing pool. To its new purposes of 578. So if we take the 578 and the 500 and add them together, you can see that that what constituted the approved budgets that we've talked about in the past compared to what our current projection is, we have a variance of $37,318. So I really don't think we have a significant variance at this moment on what our projected total cost at completion will be. The other projects, the tennis courts and parking lot that was started in FY14-15 and is now complete, the roof replacement that is almost complete, the relocation of the front office and the ADA improvements, the renovation of the old pool, the renovation of the old auditorium, those budgets all combined to be $6,035,000. Of that, $1.4 million was the tennis courts and parking lot that started back in 14-15 and was completed last summer. So we're right at, right on the target that the board approved. It was about $4.5 million for the other projects exclusive of the tennis courts and parking lot, which was approved the prior year. So we're right on target with all of those other projects there. The roof replacement, for example, we were about $100,000 under the budget on that, but we're going to be a little over, a little under on each of these different line items we have. So we're keeping track in the discrete categories that the board approved line by line, but we're focused as well on the grand total. And we may move some between lines there because we're focused on being under that grand total when all is said and done. And right now, we look like that we're actually going to accomplish that. We're still working on VE. We're still looking for opportunities for savings. There are still some things that change. There are some additional change order costs that we know about that will be coming. But I think that we go back to that first slide, that grand total at the $28 million, whatever it was, for all projects combined, including FF&E, that's our target, and we don't want to come to you and ask for more money. Right now, we think we're going to be able to do that. The moment we think that we might not be able to do that, we're going to tell you. We're not going to sneak up on you at some point and say we've got a big problem with money. For the schedule, we still are targeting July 30 of 2016 for completion of the pool and October 31st for the completion of the auditorium. The all other projects, I'm going to say there's one exception. We made the pool, the old pool, may not be done July 30th. We don't want to start on the old pool until we know the new one's going to be ready, and we're working through that and want to make sure there's a place to swim for kids. So there's some adjustments there, but right now we're not changing any of those targets. But Brian tells me often that the most difficult one is the new pool. Right now, the most schedule risk is with the new pool. We're not changing the projected completion date of July 30, but we know we've got to work really hard between now and July 30 to make that schedule. So that's where we currently have the most risk. We're a lot more comfortable that the auditorium will be done. The other projects actually affect school starting and so forth, so those are kind of non-negotiable. That's the renovation of the old auditorium, the moving of the front office and the ADA improvements and things like that. So those have to be done when school starts. Our focus schedule-wise is on making sure that we do everything that's necessary to get the new pool done by July. So I have Mr. Hedgren, Mr. Page, and myself prepared to answer questions you may have and to hear any concerns you may have.
Any questions by the board?
And Mr. McKissick?
How about students, school board members? Nothing? Well, I guess you made a great presentation there. Izzy, were you? Okay.
I don't know if you can answer this, but how often do Central use their swimming?
Great question. It's used virtually every day. We obviously have physical education courses that are in the pool from time to time, but we also have a boys swimming program mm-hmm. and a girls swimming program. The girls are in the fall, the boys are now. At the same time, we also have an age group program that uses it many evenings a week, as well as we have a sharing agreement with Palmer. And Palmer uses it in the evening, too, if they provide a lifeguard. So it's a very well-used area.
Well, I only asked because I didn't even know for the longest time. I went to Central for a minute. I didn't even know that they had a pool. Thanks.
Sure. Director DeSalvo.
Just a couple of comments. First of all, I hope you're making a space for those boys to men, because I think that's a very important group, and give them some new digs because they deserve it. Then the other question I have, and I'm more of a clarification just for everybody still here, that these are huge figures that are flying up on that screen, and we are constantly talking about budget reductions, and we're looking for money, and we're lobbying to the state to get this equity and funding for education. And I would just like it to be clarified that the money that is used for buildings and things like this is a totally different bucket, so to speak, than the general fund that we're all fighting for, that Izzy is shaking her head because she's been lobbying and got that bill passed in the Youth Congress. So totally, totally different things. And I spread the word because people must just think that we are crazy. You drive up Brady or down Harrison and you think, wow, look at that construction. How can the Davenport Community Schools afford that? And then every other minute you see them on the media saying we don't have any money. So there's a big difference in where those funds come from and what the state allows us to spend that money on. So it's very important that our community understand that, because we do have a serious problem in getting funding for education to pay for our teachers and textbooks and things that we need to keep our schools operational. And so this is a wonderful, wonderful project. And I'm very proud that it's going up. But I just want to make that clear. So thank you.
Any other comments or questions? Director Kluel.
I have to add a caveat to Director DeSalvo's comments. It appears that even with the save money, we may be having a battle on our hands with the governor, who is proposing that we use part of the save money now for clean water. So nothing is sacred. And while I've got the floor, I just had a question from some of Mr. McKissick's tennis friends about the courts being locked up. I understand they are locked up. Is that correct?
The new courts?
The new courts.
Yeah, the old ones aren't there anymore. right now, I don't believe the nets up currently.
I just heard a couple months ago that they went by and they thought the courts were closed to the public. They were locked up.
I think long-term they won't be. If they are now, you know, that's unbeknownst to me. I'm not sure that they have the nets up either at this point.
Do you think we would have a concern about, I mean, it's remote from a school building. Mm-hmm. Will we have a concern about vandalism?
I think that's certainly a real concern. You know, it's not a space that's particularly well controlled. You know, it's behind other spaces. Lighting there is a challenge. So I think that'll always be an issue. And one of the things that Mr. Scott pointed out too is there's additional construction that's going on around that space, or will be shortly, with the possibility of an additional sidewalk that's going to run from that area toward the new softball complex. So there's a lot of grading and things that I'm sure are going to have to be done, and that may also be a reason why things are locked up now. I don't think going forward at some point that you know, it's probably unrealistic to think that the public won't be able to use those at some time.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody else? All right, I've just got a couple of things. Thinking about security, it was interesting. I was wondering if Director Kluhl was getting close to suggesting that we put some cameras in over there.
Wasn't going there.
Okay, I was just anticipating, I guess.
Golden Pass key lock to the courts.
Mike, I was thinking about, could you tell us roughly where the monies are coming from? Save is a big part, but can you say like how many millions
about
are saving?
Just under 9 million and some is coming from bond, from second series of bonds. I don't recall the exact numbers. The preponderance is save, and a smaller portion, 3-4 million or so, is Pebble.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Pebble was in there somewhere.
Yes.
So I wanted to thank a few people because of that. One was, I was thinking about our forward-thinking legislators. And they're working on this sometime in the past to get those saved dollars for us and to set them aside for this kind of infrastructure for every student in the state. And I think it is important. I want to thank others that were involved in that legislation or moving that legislation, including the IASB. I know that they had a pretty big role, and I'm sure there were others involved in that. I wanted to thank, really, I guess, most of our state community as they buy things and allow, through the SAVE program, allow this money to come to us. It's all really important, and without all of those things working, we wouldn't have this kind of money to build this kind of great facility. So that's about it. All right, any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. Great presentation. We'll move on to the budget. Superintendent Tate.
Thank you, Mr. President. I provided you what I call the superintendent's guideline for budget recommendations, and then an updated preliminary draft of superintendent budget presentation. I wanted to put the guidelines out. I've talked about this in years past, but I haven't this year, that whenever I make recommendations to you, I'm basing it on trying to minimize any impact to classroom teaching and learning. And also, once I've done that, I do try to do balance reductions. In other words, not try to take or propose reductions from any one area, but try to look all throughout the budget and suggest reductions. So again, we've got some balance. And then as much as possible, make sure that we make reductions so that every employee who wants to have a job here in the district will have a job, and following on that, that we do a timely, make the timely decisions, so we don't have to give pink slips to everybody while we're waiting for the state to make any decision. So again, those are sort of my guidelines, and if the board has any like that, that they want to, as we make discussions, they want to impose, and certainly let me know. So the draft superintendent budget presentation, we need to make sure that everybody knows this is not a final budget. It's still very much in the preliminary discussions, and almost every meeting we'll be having these discussions. And this budget is has an assumption of supplemental state aid of 1.25%. As we know, the governor has proposed 2.45, the Senate has proposed 4, the House proposed 2, and that we just have to see where we land, and most importantly, I hope that we know very shortly where we land, because it'll make it easier for us to make decisions and for everybody to know exactly what's happening. But you can see on the bottom here that if in fact it was a 2% SSA, state supplemental aid, that our reduction would be about $5.5 million. And if it was a 2.5% SSA, then we're looking at about a $4,850,000. And then if we were to get 3%, that our reduction would be about $4,150,000. Again, it's using the actual that we know our enrollment is only reduced by 20 this year, and personnel increase costs of about 2%. As we go down, I want to make some points about the health insurance reserve fund. I haven't put anything down for that. Our current balance is $31 million. After I make a short presentation, I'd like for you to talk to me about that. How do you feel? What are you thinking? What's your philosophy? So at least I will know where we're going or not going with that. I have changed the J.B. Young school closure to $1.5 million. So that's after we took out $400,000 for some of the transfer options that you approved at a previous meeting. We're still looking at possible transportation efficiencies from rerouting or adjusting bell times, and that's in the works, and hopefully I will have some numbers for you very soon from that. I'd like to point out that I've added a line item by revising the out-of-district rules and the diversity plan. This year, we'd save $150,000, and cumulative, that will add up as we go year to year. We are studying what happens if we increase the number of hours we attend or minutes that we attend school and perhaps save a week or two of school. What would be our savings? And then we also have to look at the pros and cons for doing that. What would we lose? What would we gain? And then Director Kuhl asked us, well, what happens? What do we need to do? How much would we lose if we reconstitute our unspent balance over 7 years? So you can see at the bottom what we simply did was just add $1 million each year to what we have to reduce, because that's what we'd have to do if we want to reconstitute the unspent balance. So that's all I have to report. There's some very minor changes, but I'm interested in your questions, your thoughts, suggestions. But most appropriately, I think it's time for the board to start weighing in on the health insurance reserve fund. Is it something that you want us to consider as I'm finalizing my recommendation to you?
Director DeSalvo.
I think it was last meeting we talked about this. So my understanding is they would get sort of a holiday from paying their health insurance during this time period when we would use this reserve.
Let's re-explain that so everybody understands.
What would happen is in 1 month, the district would not put money from the general fund into the self-insurance fund, and that's where the savings would occur, would be in the general fund. That also affects the employees. Whatever contribution they make towards the health insurance for that month, that also would not come out of their check. So there would be a two-part. It's not a savings, but it is a savings to the employee.
Sure.
So then what would happen is we take the money we need to pay the medical bills from the reserve, which would reduce the reserves.
reduced, that 31 million would be reduced by what we would have to take from.
Right.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Director Snyder.
And what is the recommended reserve for a self-insured fund like we have?
I'm trying to remember. I believe it's between 6 months and a year as to where they recommend you have a fund balance. And we typically spend between $30 to $31 million a year out of that fund.
So we have essentially about a year.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else? Any student school board members? Okay, Director DeSalvo.
Do we need any kind of approval of the union to do this? Or do we just notify them appropriately? And
what are you talking about? This,
the health plan. I mean, let's say we decide to move forward with taking that money for that 1 month.
So the responsibility, the board has a responsibility of establishing the tax levy rate, I believe, and all of that will be in accordance with a certified budget that I believe is due April 15th. The recommendations that are made are by the administration and especially the superintendent. And the superintendent, my understanding, has all of that authority to make these decisions. And he's simply asking us on the health insurance holiday or however you want to describe it. He needs to know what board members are thinking. Should we move in that direction or not? Because it's not really affecting the budget. It's just affecting, I guess, our expenditures.
And I don't know of any contract issues we're violating by using that. Long as they're still getting their insurance, they are getting a holiday too, so we're collecting less money from them.
Anybody else? Director Kluwel.
Well, I mean, it does nothing for us in the long term. I'm just wondering what the superintendent's recommendation might be.
I would recommend that we dip into it. And although it's not going to help us for the year after, we're in a crisis mode. We need to pause a bit till I think that the legislature catches up with our needs as far as the supplemental state aid, and we see where the legislature is going with our use of our reserve fund for the adding $175 per student. So I haven't figured out an amount yet because I'm waiting to see how a lot of these other things settle, but I would come back to you and recommend that we dip into it.
So it would be in a sense of optimism that the state will come around and fund us adequately.
I'm always optimistic, but cautious.
But I would just say that we did just hear that the recommendation is to keep 6 months of need on reserve at all times, and we have twice that at this time. Correct? Is that, I understood that correctly? Okay. I would support that then.
Director Snyder.
A one-time savings here would be approximately how much money for an insurance holiday?
1 month is 2 million. Is that?
I believe it's just slightly under that. In fact, I just made myself a note to check tomorrow to see how much it would be.
You mean a 1 month holiday? How much you would say? Okay.
Did you have more, Director Snyder?
Nope.
Oh, okay. Anybody else? Well, I've got a couple more things while you're all thinking about it. There's something about the numbers that I'm a little confused with. If the insurance holiday is 2 million or rough numbers, that would be 24 million in a year, which would say that our expenditures would be between 12 and 24 instead of 15 and 31. No, it's kind of been about where it's been for the last few years. I don't know where, there's something jumbling around in my head saying there's, maybe I'm misunderstanding.
I'd have to get, I can provide you more detail as to what goes in there on a monthly basis and what our typical expenditures are. I think that would help.
Okay. I don't know that it's that big a deal. You know, I look at if we, because one of the things we've discussed in the past is a way to institutionalize the holiday. If we're over funding the fund, would it be possible to decrease our premium so that the premium more closely reflected what the real costs were? And I think you've answered in past years and said basically no, we can't do that.
You could do that. We have been very fortunate in the past couple of years, several years, of always being able to find another savings for the self-insurance fund, whether it's been that we have gone out and sought different providers, changed our network. It seems like every year we're doing something that's helping keep the costs down. It would only take one or two bad years with some bad claim experience and not be able to find those savings that would deplete that fund balance on a pretty quick basis.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Even though it's a one-time deal, I generally support it. I have in the past. And that if it's 2 million and if we have 2.7 million that we're dipping into the reserve, we've got $4.7 million right there without any real cuts, I think. But neither one of them really affect the budget, right?
Well, I mean, they're an extra budget, but that 2.7 million is figured into the 6.5 that we need to reduce.
Right, but I mean, that's not money that it's not really part of our budget. Like you say, it's right. Extra budget, right?
Correct.
Yeah, so it looks to me like we've got $4.7 million that are not money that we should be able to spend. If I'm thinking about it, right?
It is, but again, we also have, our projection looking at next year, if we continue to operate exactly as we are now, is 6.5 million if we only get 1.25. So we need to just keep figuring how to make that up. So if we took 2 million from the fund, now we're at 4.5 we need to cut. If it's only a 1.25, so.
I accept all this, and I want to move forward with all of this. The thing that's frustrating to me is that we don't have the money to spend, and we're having to find these other places for it. I guess I will say reluctantly, although one of the things I've been thinking about is there a way to express something to our legislature or to our state by using our budget situation? And I don't know if you've had a chance to think about that, but if we didn't have the insurance holiday and the $2.7 million dipping into the reserve fund available, it would be dramatically different, I think. All right, well, I got a headache. Any other discussion? Superintendent Tate, you haven't heard a lot of weigh-in on the insurance holiday. Are there any other board members that want to weigh in on this? This is something that the superintendent is going to work on this. We have to do it. There is a sense of urgency over the next, 3 months? And I think only two board members have weighed in on that insurance holiday. I'd appreciate any more weigh-ins on whether or not the superintendent should consider should continue to consider that. Director Snyder.
I mean, ultimately, right now, we're looking for sustainable savings that we can see year in and year out. But right now, since we do have that fund there, it's been how long? Did we dip into that last year, or was it 2 years ago?
2 years ago. We did. We didn't last year, to my knowledge, did we?
I support it, again, because I, too, have a little bit, I'm not going to say confidence, I'm going to say hope, in our legislators, that they can give the entire state the funding it needs for education.
Director Hayes.
I think my word I would use is optimism that they make, but I do support it. You know, we're getting much closer, and, you know, maybe we'll be surprised. Maybe not.
Okay, thank you. Director Gosa or Director Kluel? You want to weigh in? Director Gosa.
You said you guys dipped into this a couple years ago. Was there any feedback, I guess, from the unions? Because essentially that is part of their health care too, correct? And they have a vested interest in it?
Yeah, not to my knowledge, unless somebody else receives some information from the union.
I was just curious what their stance on it was.
I just haven't heard.
Okay.
Do you want to express an opinion?
I guess I would propose that you reach out to them and ask them what their thoughts are on that, because, I mean, they're vested in that too. I don't know how your guys' works out, but I know my union health insurance stuff, my contractors are liable with just the same as I am. So
I understand that, but do you want to express an opinion about whether or not you support the insurance holiday?
I would like to hear what they have to say about it before I weighed in on anything, because I wouldn't want to do something that, like you said, there's consequences to things you do.
Okay, thank you. Director Kluel. Okay, great, thank you. Any other discussion on this issue? Superintendent Tate, you have what you need?
I do, and I thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll move on to administrative reports.
None.
I have not received any board requests. There are none, right? Okay. Oh. Okay. Okay. Well, then I guess I'll ask for a motion to adjourn. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
This meeting is adjourned.